Hi, my name is Murthy Upmaka. I am an applications engineer for Keysight Technologies. In this video, I'm going to present some of the costly mistakes that we can avoid in designing a phased array system. Phased array systems have been built for the last several decades. Mostly, they have been confined to the aerospace defense industry. But with 5G phased arrays, with 5G technologies, the phased arrays are becoming more universal and commercialized. Both of these industries have become sensitive to the cost of producing due to competition. While phased arrays have been being developed and deployed successfully, there is still a growing need to avoid costly mistakes. The cost for an engineer is not getting it right first time and iterating the design multiple times. The cost for a project or program manager is not getting the phased array developed in time and within allocated budget. The cost for a company is time to market at the right price. Fortunately, new techniques and new simulation methodologies can help avoid these costly mistakes. In this video, let us discuss the top three costly mistakes that can be and should be avoided. Mistake 1. Not predicting the far-field spurious emissions in the simulation. Whether it is an aerospace defense or a commercial communications system, it must pass the test of a spurious emissions mask. The masks are specific to each application, but the requirement remains the same. In the case of phased array, due to the added spatial dimension, the SEM test is more elaborate and is conducted in an anechoic chamber. The SEM test is conducted over the entire sphere or 4 pi solid angle for all the desired beam directions in both azimuth and elevation. This very laborious procedure will be repeated if the spurious emissions are found for first time in the chamber, and then they have to be corrected in the design and brought back to the chamber again. If one can predict them upfront in the design cycle, the time spent in the anechoic chamber can be greatly reduced. Let us see how these spurious emissions can be predicted. The key requirements are ability to model and simulate accurately the nonlinearity of various nonlinear components like mixers and amplifiers. Number 2, ability to simulate the large number of channels quickly. 3, ability to visualize the spurious emissions in the far field very intuitively. Let's see a phased array transmitting block diagram. As shown here, we have 1 GHz IF being upconverted to 10 GHz and then split into 400 different channels, each channel being phase shifted and attenuated and amplified before each channel is connected to a single element of the antenna element of the array. The front-end electronics is connected to individual antenna elements. It is possible to model the front-end electronics accurately from system parameters or actual measured data provided by the vendor. The antenna elements can also be accurately modeled by bringing the measured or simulated element patterns and the S parameters of the array matrix. Once simulated, we can plot 3 different intuitive graphs. Graph number 1, EIRP plot in the far field. As can be seen in the block diagram, there can be various frequencies generated apart from the desired signal due to the nonlinearities, and all these various frequencies will be transmitted by the array. And in the far field, all these frequencies are present. So we need to get a global picture of all these frequencies in the far field. The far field plot of EIRP shown here presents one such plot. In an anechoic chamber, we have to repeat this three-dimensional pattern measurement for each one of these frequencies. So you can already see that it's a very cumbersome measurement. We presented the colorful graph as the desired signal at 10 gigahertz, and then rest of all of them combined in a gray or white plot as spurious patterns. By looking at this, we know that there are spurious frequencies. There are spurious frequencies radiated in the far field. What we are interested in is actually to suppress these spurious patterns. So we take the maximum value and then work on it. Once we reduce the maximum value radiated in a particular direction, it's hopeful that all the other directions it will be in general be reduced. So we have another plot. We can do the spectrum in the far field. We can look at it and then more intuitively present it in a two-dimensional plot, but with a three-dimensional information. What we see in this graph number 2 is power versus frequency of various spurious products generated in the chain along with the desired signal. And then if we hover the mouse at the tip of each one of these frequencies, that represents the direction in which maximum power is transmitted for each one of these frequencies. This is a very useful plot. In fact, this plot gives all sorts of possible combinations and permutations of the nonlinear products. We can actually choose those few of them and then start working from there. But still, this plot doesn't tell if these spurious emissions are passing a spectral emission mask, spurious emissions mask or not. So that brings us to the number 3, graph number 3, where we plot the phi cut along with superimposed with the spurious emissions mask, as shown here in graph number 3. We can easily see that the main signal is fairly passing the spectral emissions mask, whereas a undesired signal at 8 gigahertz, which is an intermodulation product, is violating the mask, and we need to identify this, the direction of product, and then try to suppress it. There can be several solutions that a designer can come up with, but here we are taking one of the approaches to suppress this product. The filter in the block diagram, immediately after the mixer and amplifier, is originally designed with a bandwidth of going from 9.2 to 10.8 gigahertz. We reduced this bandwidth, the bandpass filter characteristic, from that to 9.5 to 10.5 gigahertz. Then when we simulated and plotted the spectral emission mask along with all the phi cuts of all the signal and spurious, we can easily see that most of the spurious is pushed well below the spectral emissions mask. This indicates that we can very effectively simulate and identify and rectify the spurious emissions in undesired directions that are violating the spectral emissions mask or spurious emissions mask. One has to repeat this phi cut at various phi cuts. One has to repeat these simulations and make sure that the spectral emissions mask is validated for each one of them. If we did not use a proper methodology and tool to predict the spurious radiation in the far field, we would have to spend a lot of time in the anechoic chamber uncovering the failure of SEM test. Fixing these and validating again would be very expensive. Okay, let us come to the mistake number 2, failing to explore the design thoroughly in the simulation phase. Why would anybody not explore the design in simulation space? There can be many reasons, but the simulation speed and the accuracy of modeling comes into play. One troubling behavior of phased arrays is coupling between the elements. The cost of phased array is directly proportional to the size of the array. It is tempting to reduce the inter-element spacing, but unfortunately that leads to increased coupling between the elements. The coupling can happen by several means. If the lines in the feed network are close, they get coupled. An element not only transmits but also can potentially receive the energy from adjacent radiating elements. This appears as the reflected energy back into the element's input. A third mechanism can also happen if the elements are realized on the same substrate. Higher order surface modes can be excited, propagated, and ultimately radiated. All these effects must cause loss of directivity in certain directions called blind angles. Unless one models the coupling effects and impedance mismatches accurately and explore the design over all the scan angles, these blind spots cannot be uncovered. A typical simulation shows a mild form of loss of directivity shown in the figure. Mistake number 3. Relying on simple spreadsheet-like calculations. It's very popular to use spreadsheets to design RF systems. Spreadsheets are attractive to the RF system designers since they are readily available and quick to simulate, but they lack the capability to model and simulate. For example, spreadsheets cannot model multiports, RF mismatches, finite isolation between ports, frequency response of the parts, accurate nonlinearity of amplifiers and mixers, like accurate noise, like phase noise, correlated, uncorrelated noise, etc. While these are certainly limitations to design even a single path RF system, they become severe limitations in the design of phased array. The designer needs to have insights into all the paths. If you remember the previous block diagram, we had 400 different paths. We need to look into all the 400 paths to understand the behavior. Because a phased array, we cannot simulate one path and scale it up to 400 paths. We need to consider all of them simultaneously. Under certain conditions, the amplifiers in the arrays are compressed. Due to this compression, we can see that the spurious radiation is violating the SEM as shown in the pictures. That's because some of the amplifiers in some of the chains are being driven into compression or even saturation. So how do we identify these amplifiers? The tools make it easy to identify these. And as can be seen in the table here, the central elements receive the maximum power. Amplifier connected to the element numbers 190, 210, 191, 211 are the highest compressed amplifiers. The next level will be shown in the blue box, and the next level will be in the yellow box. Now we know where the nonlinearity is coming from. So if we can take care of these amplifiers, we would have probably solved the problem of the side lobe that is violating the spectral emissions mask. In conclusion, we have seen that phased array system design is much more complex than a single RF system design. One cannot just scale up the analysis of a single RF path analysis to a full array. Not following the modern design simulations and modeling methodologies will become costly mistakes. You can download the system view workspaces I used in this video by clicking the link below in the description to try out on your own design. I hope you enjoyed the video. Thank you.